Hello and welcome to The Works, I'm Ben Che. The members of the band Diamond Six, a trio that first got together in 2017, say they feel their music has evolved from heavy and sludgy to a distinct blend of classic hard rock with unique vocal harmonies. In this week's show, you can judge for yourself. They'll be joining us later in the studio. Artists have used pigment derived from stones to write and paint since the prehistoric era. The Mogao Grotto murals in northwest China, the earliest known examples of mineral pigment paintings in China, were created more than 1,500 years ago. Some mineral pigments are hard to get hold of due to the scarcity of rare gems, but the characteristic grainy texture of mineral colors still attracts some artists. One of them is Chung Tai-fu, who has been working with mineral pigments since 2005.
Across this small holding grow passion fruits, hairy gourds, and a range of other crops. Chung Tai-fu is not here to harvest any of them. Here's an artist rather than a farmer. He's here for something else. Chung became acquainted with the use of mineral pigments in art while studying printmaking in the Tokyo National University of Arts and Music in the 1980s. At the time, mineral pigments were too expensive for him. It wasn't until 2005, while visiting friends in mainland China, that he found affordable mineral pigments. He began using it in his work, strongly attracted by its natural luster. While pigments from stones and rocks contain a single mineral, pigments from soil is a mix of minerals. Some of the earth pigments Chung uses are those he collects himself. In the 1980s and 1990s, as a printmaker, he received multiple international awards. Today, he still uses silkscreen printing to make preparatory drafts for his mineral pigments paintings. To cut costs, he uses the earth pigments for this.
我可以用好多攝影嘅圖像，我亦都可以用一啲電腦軟件去幫我創作一張畫嘅構圖，同埋我過稿嘅時候會快好多。咁喺我嘅創作裏邊咧，就可以好集中喺個描繪方面，就唔喺前期嘅製作方面。
The mineral pigments has to be mixed with gelatin to be applied. Yet the gelatins can reduce the original luster of the mineral particles.
如果我呢一浸色係底色咧，我可以落多少少膠。若果我呢浸色係面色嘅咧，我就盡量落少膠。 我唔想有張膠紙包住嗰粒鑽石。如果係重要嘅地方，可能要畫四五浸嘅。譬如我係要畫一塊枯咗嘅葉，咁我開始嘅時候真係未必係畫一隻咖啡色啊嗰啲落去嘅。 因為我亦都知道礦物顏料佢係可以個層次係好豐富嘅，同埋可以透到個底嘅顏色嘅。我好可能咧喺底嗰陣咧，我會畫一隻草綠色落去，或者係墨綠色落去。咁畫完咗之後，再等佢乾咗，再喺上邊蓋一隻啡色落去。
Chung founded the Society of Mineral Pigment Arts of Hong Kong in 2021. The society had its inaugural exhibition last year. Although this technique has a long history in China, dating back at least to the Mogao Grotto murals, mineral pigments can just as easily be used by artists to make contemporary art today. Recently, Chung held a solo exhibition of his mineral pigment art. The main theme was the flower. In many of his works, Chung applies gold or silver foil. It's a technique adopted from Japanese painting, and it can be a challenge.
睇畫嘅時候，即係你明明睇住佢本來係最淺色嘅地方，但係當你行到去另一個位置嘅時候，最淺色嘅地方可能就變成最深色嘅地方，即係在乎佢同嗰個環境互相嗰個關係有一個互動嘅。
Chung's salute to Van Gogh series is a foray into a new artistic style. Instead of applying foil, he splashes pigments on the background. His works have transformed from their earlier subtle tones to a passionate and bold selection of colors. Chung sees some parallels between his own artistic journey and that of Van Gogh.
我開始嘅時候咧就係做一個粒版畫嘅藝術工作者啦。我大部分嘅版畫都係黑色啊、灰色啊，冇乜顏色嘅，就算有顏色都係好淡嘅顏色。咁但係到我而家六啊幾歲嘅年齡咧，我反為係中意一啲豐富嘅顏色。睇翻梵谷嘅一生咧，佢開始嘅時候咧，即係喺礦洞裏邊用炭枝去畫嘅一啲畫。 開始嘅時候亦都係只係黑色同白色，咁到佢最後所描繪嘅畫咧，都係顏色好豐富、好激情。From
printmaking to mineral pigments painting, in his 60s, Chung is still challenging himself with new materials and looking for new breakthroughs.
因為我凡係用咗一種物料之後，我覺得表現力係已經係我所能力冇辦法再有跨進一步嘅時候，我就會係利用物料去令我有少少突破。呢個係我自己即係對自己一個考驗嘅其中一個方法咯。Signals
Gallery was set up in London in 1964 by David Medalla and Guy Brett. It soon became one of the first British galleries to focus on international experimental art movements from Fluxus to Kinetic and Op art, and had a profound impact on the UK's art scene. At Parasite, the exhibition series Signals Sunsik pays homage to the Signals Gallery and focuses on an expanded understanding of kinetics or movement through a medley of scores, abstraction, and rhythms. The second chapter of this ongoing series, Signals, Folds, and Splits, will explore the ways artists challenge conventions of time in a climate of instability.
Thank you.
Welcome back. The three members of Diamond Six describe their music style as explosive hard rock. They're strongly influenced by bands like Stone Temple Pilots, Alice in Chains, Royal Blood, and Rush. When the trio first got together in 2017, they had the aim to play one gig only, but have so far released 17 singles on various streaming platforms. Diamond Six are now set to bring their punchy sound to a wider audience, and they're here to tell us more. Okay, Pete, Matt, Gavin, Diamond Six, welcome to The Works.
Hello,
thanks for having us.
So let's start by talking about the band. How did you guys meet, and what was the inspiration behind starting Diamond Six?
I love playing shows, and I hadn't played a show in about 4 years, and I was just getting unhappy, a bit depressed, and I thought, I think I know what the problem is. I just need to play a live show. So I thought, well, I need to get a band together. So I called up my old buddy, Gavin, who I've known since I was like 11 or 12. Like, Gavin, help me just play one show, and then that's it. You'll never hear from me again. I won't bother you again. Just one show. Just let me get this out of my system, you know, because right. I'm going crazy here. I was like, yeah, okay. Do you have a drummer? And I heard about this guy, Matt, who I just saw on YouTube.
Nice.
I found out somebody who knew him, had his number. So I just gave him a call out of the blue. It's like, Matt, my name's Pete. Could you play a gig with me? Said, yeah, okay. we all met up.
It's only one gig.
And it was just one gig, and I think I had three or four original songs. I'm like, hey guys, hear the songs.
Right.
So we played a gig, we played at the Wunch, and it was a lot of fun. And I just, for me anyway, I was just like, okay, great, that's good. But then a couple of days later, or I can't remember, either Gav messaged me or something like that. I can't really remember now. And he's like, yeah, let's do this again. And that was the beginning of it.
Awesome. And from there, you've now ended up with almost like 17 original songs.
Yeah, yeah.
So talk us through that process. How what was the journey from that to now? How did that happen?
Okay, so in the beginning, Pete had a whole bunch of songs he wanted to kind of get out in the open. So we kind of quickly managed to get a couple of songs going. But as time went by, you know, I was like, you know what? Let's switch up our style a little bit. Maybe I'll bring something new to the table, you know, with some chord change and harmonies instead of just screaming. And then suddenly we've got all these songs out, and then we just kind of got better at writing songs. And we went, hey, you know what? We're excited for the next new one. Let's see what we can come up with. And then it just snowballed. And then now we've got 17, 18 songs.
But let's talk about the songwriting process. I mean, you know, a lot of you guys grew up in the 90s, so I'm hearing a lot of big guitar sounds, a lot of guitar-driven rock. How does the songwriting process work for you as a band?
Usually, well, Gab and I are the main songwriters, and just to put it quite simply, one of us just turns up to the studio and says, guys, I've got a new song that I've written. And with Gab, it's usually pretty much a 99 to 100% complete. And maybe Matt just jumps in and says, let's do a change here, and maybe I throw in my two cents.
Right.
And with me, it's pretty much similar. And there are a few occasions where I've written something and Gav's like written the bridge to it, and we've just mixed it up a bit. Gav came in with all the music.
Right.
And at that point in time, I was doing more vocals, so I went away and wrote the lyrics and the vocal melody. And then Gav jumped in and put in some melodies and some harmonies, and it just all kind of gelled together. And then in the end, Gavin ended up just doing the main vocals for it, and it just went from there. But generally, yeah, Gavin just turns up with a song that's 100%, or I do the same thing. Like, hey guys, here it is.
Right.
What do you think?
Nice. And you've recorded most of your songs as well, right?
Yeah.
But even with the songs coming out, I noticed that you put a music video to each of the songs.
Yeah.
Was that a conscious or intentional decision?
I was working with a graphic designer for a while, and who's really good at just doing some small animations. So for the ones that we did the music video for, that was obviously a conscious effort. But you know, for the other ones, we were just saying, can you make that twinkle or whatever? And then that way we just sort of had something a little bit more than just a static album cover. On the songs,
right?
Yeah,
very cool.
And then another one was like while I was in quarantine, playing with animation software, and then I was like, "Hey guys, what do you think of this?" And, and it turns out they liked it.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Left and right.
It's like a metronome, swinging in time with the music. Yeah, yeah. And then we copy that and make lots of them, and like raindrops falling down, and all sorts of other weird things.
Right. But speaking of live gigs, any plans for 2023 or 2024, specifically for your band?
I think our main goal right now is to try to get onto festivals where we can reach a larger audience. Mm. I think right now for us to have our own show is going to be a little bit risky. It's you know, because you have to rent a venue, you're not sure how many people you're going to bring in, so it's a big risk. So I think right now we're just going to focus on putting stuff out on social media and trying to get onto festivals would be our goal. And playing originals, that's challenging. That's yeah, always challenging.
Right. Well, I think you guys have a great sound. I mean, just that the guitar, the bass, and the drums, like individually, but such a big sounding sort of combination.
Thanks.
So let's hear a song. You're in the studio. You've got all your gear here with you today. What song would you like to play? And tell us the story behind that song.
Far From Home. Gav wrote the music for it, and I remember when he showed me the music to it. I was like, okay, yeah, there's definitely something here. I had no idea what to do guitar-wise, but anyway, it all fell into place. But where I start from, it's all very cinematic for me. The song is about a girl in the future who has been kidnapped, and there's an interdimensional traveler who's helping to save her.
Oh, okay. Wow. Yeah. Very
deep.
Very deep.
It's pretty crazy stuff. And when I explain that to some people, they're like, what? I didn't see that. I didn't read into that at all. I don't know where you're coming from. I'm like, it's true, I wrote the lyrics. And people are like, nah, no, I don't believe you. It's not that. Yeah. Awesome. So everybody makes their own mind up, you know?
Nice. Well, I look forward to hearing it. Thank you to all of you for coming in. And let's hear the song.
Thanks, man.
Thanks.
Just let it ring out.